Joining me now is Herald Sun columnist Patrick Carlyon. Patrick, good to see you. Let's start in the US. Thanks, former President Barack Obama has stopped short in endorsing Kamala Harris as the party's nominee. Instead, he says he wants the party to create a process from which an outstanding nominee emerges. Why won't he back her, do you think?
Well, that's the million-dollar question, isn't it, really? I mean, it's such a powerful statement. You've got most of the other Democrats, the hierarchy sort of falling in behind Kamala Harris, and you have probably the most powerful of them saying, hang on, I'm not sure about this. Let's see who is the most outstanding candidate. This is something that the Republicans will definitely use. It's something that sort of muddles the Democrat attempts to try and sort of build a solidarity. And it is very telling that he's saying this at this point in time. The implication is that Obama doesn't think that she is the most outstanding candidate.
And, you know, it's interesting because for weeks the Democrats have been peddling this narrative that Donald Trump is a threat to democracy, but now they are being caught in a lie and have kicked off the ticket, the one candidate they allowed to stand. The American people are surely smart enough to figure out who is the real threat to democracy. What do you think, Patrick?
Well, I actually agree with J.D. Vance, and I wrote about this the other week. In America, they've got the 25th Amendment, and that sort of stands, that can be invoked if a sitting president is seen to be unfit. Now, Joe Biden's not going very well physically and mentally. We've all seen that. The evidence for that is overwhelming. And he's going to be there for another 6 months. That's a long time when you're going downhill fast. There are so many questions to be asked about how he was protected from, scrutiny during the last 6 months and perhaps even longer in a way that really did hide the fact that he really was very unwell.
Well, look, it's extraordinary he wants to stick around between now and November. He can't run for president yet, seems to be able to be there until that day. Now, Patrick, hundreds of journalists for the Nine papers are threatening to go on a 5-day strike during the Paris Olympics as boss Mike Sneesby comes increasingly under fire for the 200 job cuts he made across the company. Now, this strike is over pay diversity and protection against AI. That's according to the Media, Entertainment and Arts Alliance. But Sneesby certainly looked in high spirits, carrying the Olympic flame through a French village. Patrick, how much pressure is Nine under internally right now?
Look, obviously it's enormous pressure. They paid $300 million for the rights to the Olympics. You've got Mike Sneesby running around with a torch in his hand while the rats are revolting back home. Somebody likened it, I think, after the 200 job cuts were announced, he flew off to Greece, and somebody likened the optics of that to Scott Morrison being in Hawaii during the bushfires, infamously. The look is terrible. Obviously, they're very serious. You cannot strike. It's the biggest event this year, really, and they're paid a lot of money for it. And if the workers aren't going to work for it, then there are big, big questions there, aren't there?
Well, there are a lot of questions and clearly a lot of internal tension, that's for sure, over at Nine. Now, the opposition is claiming that the Greens' plan to tear up liquefied natural gas export contracts and divert supply to the domestic market will raise the sovereign risk and trash the country's global reputation, but also send electricity prices soaring. But meanwhile, on housing, the Greens are openly admitting to wanting the value of our homes to decrease in order to ensure the next generation actually has a chance of buying one. Get this, in an interview with The Australian, the housing spokesperson Max Chandler-Mathis said, quote, I think our stated goal is to stop house price growth, so 0% growth, to give wages a chance to catch up. I think the net effect would be a stabilisation of house prices. Patrick, do the Greens actually have any idea what they're on about?
I think the simple answer is no. I think they're intent on trying to sort of fix the world by breaking it one step at a time. And these are just pie in the sky policies. They have no place in reality. Who would trust a Greens politician to actually wrench the levers of these economic pillars of our society in terms of housing. I mean, you know, it's the great Australian dream, the house, to save up and to buy it. It's very difficult at the moment for young people. And I think that that's where the Greens always seem to be going with these, you know, crazy sort of policies. They're trying to appeal to the young people and trying to take votes away from the Labor Party. But yeah, conjuring these really wacky ideas that sound really good but have absolutely no place in reality.
No, it's like they just drum up these ideas. They come up with it in a dream and then suddenly they're trotted out in front of the media. It's just absolutely bizarre. Now, look, this is a concern. Alice Springs has joined some of the most violent and crime-ridden areas of the world after being included in the world's 20 most dangerous cities. The list from crowdsourced data website Numbeo listed Alice Springs at number 18 as the most dangerous city, with a crime rate equal to the Mexican city of Tijuana, which currently has a murder rate of 91.7 people per 100,000. Patrick, we know that Alice Springs is ground zero for youth crime in this country in particular. There's been two lockdowns, for example, in a matter of months. Does this new data just back that up?
Absolutely. And look, one of the sad things here is this has been going on for decades. I went to Alice Springs and I went to some of the camps 10 years ago, just after there'd been riots. I was with the police officer who was saying, hang on, I think we're about to have another riot. And I mean, at that point, you're thinking, wow, this is Australia. It is a national shame that Alice Springs is the way it is. It's not any one government. You can blame this or that, but it's been going for such a long time. And the fact that it's in this survey now at such a high place in it, beggars belief. It really is a national shame that more can't be done.
No, I agree. Look, we're almost out of time, but just very quickly, have a look at this AI-generated video that the Queensland opposition put out of the Premier Stephen Miles. Oh, Patrick, I think it's hilarious. Stephen Miles is upset about it, but what do you think?
I think it's hilarious too. I think the fact that he's upset about it shows that he needs to grow up. I mean, politicians since day one have been trying to make the other side look silly. And that actually is very funny. And the fact that he's come out and it seems so glass-jawed by the fact of it, it really does beggar my belief. This is politics. Grow up.
That's it. It is politics. It's the way it is. Patrick Carlyon, good to be with you. Thanks for joining us.